Okay, so let's pick back up right where we left off with more optimization examples. So let's take a look real quick here again at the steps for when we are optimizing, which means to find a max or a min to a specific quantity. So to create a function, which is what we're going to do. So first thing we're going to have to do is identify key information, assign some variables to the quantities, and then use that information to create an objective function, the function that we want to optimize, the function that we want to find a maximum for or a minimum for. And we're going to have to use some constraints or constraint equations so that we can create a function of a single variable. So we do need to have a function of just one variable. So once we've done that, we can consider the domain of that function, consider the context as well as the actual function we've created when looking at the domain, because often context will give us some restrictions as well. And then we find the absolute maximum or minimum using calculus. And so that's where we're going to head into all of the calculus techniques that we've utilized to find maxes and mins. So that's our process, and let's look at an example. So let's suppose that we have a farmer, has 650 feet of fencing, wants to use that to enclose a rectangular area and divide it up into four pens with fencing parallel to one side of the rectangle. So there's lots of ways to draw this. If we've got a rectangular fence, we could draw those four pins. We could create rectangular fencing in this direction. We could also have done it, you know, depends, I guess, on what he wants to put into these pins, but we could have done it this way as well. We could have had more of a square-like shape. I mean, there's lots of ways that he can do this. Square-like shape, you know, something of that nature. So these are all the different possibilities, but because I'm going to label with variables anyway, you know, and things can be switched and reoriented, I'm going to just go ahead and get started here and draw in a rectangle and give it some labels. I'm going to go ahead and call this side X, this side Y, and then I'm just going to put in my parallel fencing to create those four pins. So he has this interest in creating a rectangular area with those four pens, and he wants to find the largest possible total. So keeping in mind what the goal is here, we want to maximize, right? When we're talking about optimizing, we need to know, are we looking for a maximum or a minimum? So we want to maximize, and then what is it that we want to maximize? We want to maximize the area, and the area function, or the area of this rectangular pin, all four of these pins actually, is going to be X times Y. So that's our area. Now we're going to have to work with that to create a function of a single variable, because right now area is technically a function of two variables, like area equals area as a function of X and Y is the product X times Y. But we're in single variable calculus and we don't know how to optimize a function of two variables. We know how to optimize a function of a single variable. So that's where we're going to come in here and say, well, what else is given here? And there is some definite constraints. He doesn't have endless amount of material. He has 650 feet of fencing total. So since he has some restrictions, he has 650 feet of fencing. And since that is given, we have to think about, well, how much fence does he need to create this rectangular pin with those four, this large rectangular area with four individual pins. So, I mean, who knows, maybe he's putting goats or something in here. So I'm going to go ahead and label the entire drawing now. And notice that we actually have five Y's. So if he was going to lay out this fencing, whatever he decides to be his Y length here is going to be, he needs five of those so that he can have those parallel fences put inside the interior of this larger rectangle. So we have five Y, and then he needs two X's, and total he has 650 feet of fencing. So that's our constraint. And so now we can utilize that so that I know now if I want to maximize the area, given this constraint, I can say, well, what would Y be equal to? So 5Y is 650 minus 2x divided by 5. So y is 650 divided by 5 is 130 minus 2/5 x. And that I can use. Once I've taken my constraints, I can use that and I can plug it into my optimizing equation. So since area equals x times y, area as a function of a single variable is going to be x times 130 minus 2/5 x, which is going to be 130x minus 2/5 x squared. And so now we have a function of a single variable. So a of x is my optimizing function, my objective function, the function that I want to find the maximum of. So that's the function that I'm going to use. So all of what we've done right here has actually had nothing to do with calculus, but now we're going to actually apply the calculus. So at this point, we're going to apply calculus to find the max of the area function. Okay, now before we do that, because there is context here, this particular function, as it is, has a domain, right? If it was a function without any context, the domain would actually be all reals from negative infinity to infinity. But pull back from that for a second. Remember that x represents the length, or width, however you want to think of it, of this rectangle. But it's definitely a distance. And so this doesn't make any sense in the context, right? So when we think about just the domain, if we look at just the function to come up with the domain, we lose the context. So I'm going to erase that and say that doesn't make any sense. So in the context of this particular example, the domain, for one, has to be greater than zero, okay? We cannot create a rectangular fence with a dimension that is negative. That doesn't make any sense. So in the context, x, first of all, has to be greater than zero. And then to actually create, now x can get very large, but x and y both have to have some dimension, right? So x could be like 640, okay? That doesn't leave a whole lot of space. I mean, I guess it depends on what this farmer happens to want to enclose, what she wants to enclose or what he wants to enclose. But this farmer could, if they wanted to, use 640 feet of fencing along the length and then just use a tiny amount. I guess they've got 2 feet they could do. Sorry, I'm laughing because this would be such a funny little pin. They could create something like that, and that would utilize. Oh, that doesn't even that. Nope, that doesn't make sense because then they have nothing on the other side. They could actually only they would only have. They'd have to split that 640 between the two. So they could say 6, 320 and 320. So they could create a fence. They could create a rectangular area fenced off like that. So. But we do have some restrictions. So we do have to think about, you know, basically that we could only be in order to create a rectangle, x has to be greater than zero, but at the same time for the context, x also has to be less than 325, half of that. And it has to be less than, it can't actually be equal to that. It could get close to that, but it can't be less than that. So the domain here has to be for this x, it has to be somewhere between 0 and 325, just for the context. So we could write it that way, or we could say interval notation, we could say from 0 to 325. So we do have that restriction based on the context, and it is an open interval. Again, as I mentioned, you know, in the little picture I drew up a second ago with the super long, skinny little rectangular area, we could physically, even though it might not make sense for the farmer, we could physically have a very long x value and a really small y value, or vice versa. But we are restricted by that total of 650. So I split it in two. That would be 325 and said, okay, well, we can get close to that on the x value, but we can't go past that. Otherwise, we wouldn't actually have a rectangle. Okay. That said, it is an open interval. Wanted to take a moment just to mention that you do have to kind of think about the context when you talk about the domain. We can't just say it's all reals. And then we can get into the derivative. So now let's take the derivative. So to find the maxes or the mins of a function, we take the derivative and look at the critical points. And so what is the derivative of this area function? It is going to be 130 minus 4/5 x. And then we got to find the critical points. And there's just going to be one critical point when 130 minus 4/5 x equals 0. So when 4/5 x equals 130, or when x equals 325 over 2, which is actually 162.5. feet of fence. So that's our critical point, and then we can go to a sine chart. And again, remember on our sine chart that we do have that restricted domain, but we want to prove that this is in fact, even though there's only one critical point, we do want to prove that it is in fact. So we don't need the units on it right there. But we do want to prove that it is, in fact, a maximum for the area. So we're looking at the sine. Pick something over here like 1. This is going to be positive. Pick something like 200 over here, and we're going to get a negative. So it means that we increase till we get to that point, that critical point, and then we decrease. And we know that that critical point, by the way, also is a horizontal tangent. So we know we've got a max. We also know that a prime of 162.5 equals 0. Okay, so we know that it's a max. We know that it increases and then decreases. We've proven that. We know that it's a max. I do want to just mention that we have another way that we could do this. Rather than using a sine chart, because this particular critical point is a place where the derivative equals 0. All of that part would be the same. But we could, I'll just put a little or, we could use that second derivative test. You know, I haven't used that a ton yet, but it is applicable in this case. The second derivative test says that, I'll put this kind of in a little thought bubble here. The second derivative test says if you take the second derivative, which would simply be negative 4/5, which is less than 0 always, which means we're concave down. If you're concave down and you have a critical point, you have to have this shape, which makes it a max. Okay, that's what the second derivative test says. If you have a horizontal tangent and you're concave down, then you must be a max. So x equals 162.5 must be a max. Now, of course, you don't have to do both if you've done the sine chart. And I actually tend to default just to the sine chart, especially if I have multiple critical points. But just a quick mention that we could have used that second derivative test here. So either way, we have shown that this point is a maximum, and so now all we have left to do is find y and the area. So now let's find y and area. Find that max area. So what would y be? Where is my equation for y? Y is 130 minus 2/5 x. So y is going to be 130 minus 2/5 times, I'm going to go ahead and do the 325 over 2. So y is actually 65. So y ends up being 65 feet. So we found our x. Showed that it was a max, found our y. And now we could use our area function, or we could simply just multiply since I already found y. We could just multiply 325 over 2 times 65 to find what that maximum area is. And the maximum area that we can get here is 10,500, referencing my calculator here, 562.5 feet squared. And we can state that the maximum area this farmer can enclose with his or her 650 feet of fence is 10,562.5 feet squared with dimensions x equals 325 over 2 or 162.5 feet by y equals 65 feet. And there is our answer and all of our justification. So we took our, so we followed our process. We drew a picture because this one did actually lend itself nicely to a picture. So we drew a picture, created the optimizing equation, the objective function that we were looking at. First, we started with an equation and then used the constraint to create a function of a single variable, looked at its domain, and it did have some restrictions on its domain, spent a little time talking about that, and then applied some calculus to find that actual maximum by taking the derivative and then looking at that point. And to, you do have to justify that that point is a maximum. Okay, that's another example.